so I'm just going to say a few words of introduction, then I'll introduce you to our speakers and we'll get underway. So first of all, welcome. Thanks for everyone for coming along. And I'd just like to talk a little bit about why we're here or why we feel this is an important thing to do. And I guess I can kind of actually only speak from my own perspective on this. So that's what I'll do. I think I became aware of the revolution in Rojava, which is that part of northern Kurdistan that falls within the borders of Syria. I first became aware of that a few years ago, and it seemed interesting, but I sort of immediately had this kind of fatalistic reaction to it. Like, something's happening, it's interesting, a whole load of people are involved in the project trying to do something good. And my reaction was like, this will get hopelessly crushed in no time at all. Like, it's a sort of, it's an impossibility that this thing can exist. But now, 4 years after it started, and it's still going, and in many ways seems to be doing better than it was at that point when I first contacted it. And it seems like a time to try and understand, like, it's already proved me wrong, so I feel like I should understand what this thing is and what my relationship to it should be. So I'm hoping that this is an opportunity for us all to become better informed and better equipped from that kind of perspective. You're going to hear from two knowledgeable people to explain something about the situation, but obviously the situation is a very complex one involving millions of people. So those are only two perspectives. You're not going to get any kind of like fixed truth or like perfect, you know. We're not going to be able to provide you with a vision of a utopia, or we're not going to rank Rojava in like best popular revolutions 1 to 10. But hopefully you will learn a bit more about it. And other things to cover. We're going to take questions at the end. There'll be about half an hour for Q&A. So if you've got anything, think about it during the talk. We've funded this out of our own pockets, those of us who've organised it. So if people are happy to chuck in £1 or £2 on their way out, that would be extremely helpful. And that's all, really. I don't know if it's all gone. There's a little bit of food, so rich people can have themselves too. Great. I'll just introduce our speakers, and then we'll get down to it. Nice one. Do you want to come and sit down? Cool. So this is Bilan. Bilan is a Kurdish author and Middle East analyst, and he's going to... So would you like to introduce yourself briefly?
Yeah. I thank every one of you to participate in this event tonight. I am Middle East researcher, writer, and some way politician at the same time. I've been in UK for the last 12 years, and I have been living in Bristol for 9 to 10 years. We are tonight gonna talk about the revolution in Rojava, and I do know everybody got a lot of questions in mind. I hope we're gonna give you the right and best questions to our knowledge. Thank you very much.
I'm Julio, I'm an activist. I come from Italy, and I've been in, I've not been in Rojava, but I've been in Bakur. It is the northern part of Kurdistan in Turkish territory in October. And my talk will be on based on what I've seen in just 10 days I've been there, so a very small point of view. But I hope I can give, I don't know, a bit of a different look at what's happening here, there, and what you can find online or wherever you can read about it.
Right. I would like to start with Islamic State in the Middle East, because that's the main issue right now, what is going on. I do know it is a highly complicated issue to understand, but it is always good to start from the beginning. Well, I am Kurdish. I come from Southeast Kurdistan, which is part of Turkey. As a non-state nation, the Kurds, through all the history, has been fighting for their own freedom based on the left-wing ideologies. The Kurdish movement, for the last decades, who has been fighting in the region, they did based on anti-fascism and socialism. The ISIS, to my knowledge, it is a multinational, a multi-religion, and a multi-organized terrorist organization. Some way it has been put forward, the Islamic State fighting for Muslim Islam religion. I do not agree with that sort of ideas. Islamic State, from the very beginning so far, in the Middle East, attacking the most important areas where are the richest area with its underground resources. In Iraq, in Syria, and in the other part of the Middle East. And it has been backed up by some Middle East governments, countries. The relationship between the Turkey and the Islamic State, even it is highly complicated, it is well known and evidenced. The Turkish state is one of the supporters. On besides the Saudi Arabia, another supporter to the Islamic State. Some might think, well, it is not concrete evidence, says. But as a people who has been fighting to the Islamic State from the very beginning, we did have so many evidences where they do get a financial support, where they do have a link, their militants on the ground taking the advantage. And we did find the identities on the Islamic State's militants, terrorists, belongs to some governments being issued by the Home Office. We had some passports where they get a passport, which is proved they did get backed up by some governments. The Islamic State is not a regional problem. At the same time, Islamic State is a global problem for the humanity. The fight has been going on against the Islamic State as the most successful militant groups on the ground named Kurds. We did fight under the really poor conditions because we did not have the budget. We are not a state, independent state. So in our power, whatever we've done, it is from the civil people, not just Kurds, the regional other ethnic groups, cultures, religions, and the friendly people like you gentlemen and ladies from all over the world. Islamic State recently moved into the Europe. Logical is packed, and their targets is not limited on the region. They do organized all over the world, and they do believe they can fight the whole world. The ideology which is they are in belief, it is can be defined as the most brutal terrorist organization maybe for the last 100 years. The woman has been raped systematically, kidnapped, the children has been brutally killed and burned into the fire. The villages burned to the ground, even the animals being killed by the ISIS. They are so inhuman, so brutal, so inhuman organization. Well, in that sort of matters, we do need to organize as a socialist, anti-fascist, anarchist, humanist groups all over the world. And we need to stand up with one to another so we can fight back to the ISIS. That's the main review what is going on in the Middle East. First, ISIS targeting to get into the international black market. Oil, the most important resource. And second, they want to destroy the whole region with their allies who are fighting against them. Well, let's talk about the Kurdistan. Who are the Kurds? The Kurds is the most ancient nation in the Middle East. The nation who started the agriculture first in the Middle East. The nation who are civilized first. And this is the nation never discriminate any other identities, cultures, religions. At the time of, Kurds were in power. In the history, all the religions, cultures, and nation were together in a peaceful life. This is our reference today again. Without discriminating any nation or any cultures, identity, religions, or sexuality. Well, since the First World War, Kurds has been divided into the four. One part of Kurds, under the Iranian occupation, one under the Assad regime, Syrian occupation, one part in North Iraq, and it is Kurdistan regional government now, self-defense and federation, and one part in southeast Turkey. Well, in every single part, there are different groups believing in different ideologies and fighting against the brutal regimes in the Middle East. The PKK, Kurdistan Workers' Party, one of them. The People Protection Unit in Rojava, fighting. And Kurdistan Regional Government, you know, in North Iraq, since Saddam Hussein bombed the Kurds in North Iraq, if you remember that time. And the other part in Iran. Kurds in the Middle East trying to build up a new ideology perspectives, stateless democracy. We do not believe we always need a state. In a universal world, this world belongs to every human being, and we do not need the borders between us. We do not need to fight on the nationalities, borders, and we do not need to discriminate one to another. Non-state nation Kurds in the Middle East living with other nationalities, cultures, and religions in a peaceful manner right now. And the social contract in Rojava revolution is one of, in my knowledge, is one of the best contracts where you can live together and have a future together. We do want to expand this contract all over the world who are economically being discriminated in other countries, socially being discriminated, being rejected for their identities, beliefs, religions, whatever. In total, we believe every human being should define himself as he believes or as he wants to define himself or herself. Well, in that case, we should think about it. In all over the world, so far, what solution did we have? Did the capitalist system itself bring us any solution without breaking the ecological balance of the nature? Did the capitalist system, the capitalist modernity, the capitalist civilization bring us any solution where a man and woman can live equal and in peaceful life so far? Did the capitalist system build up a peaceful life between the nations? And did the globalism, in fact, sort out the borders? No. There are arguments we are talking in our social life daily. We do believe something better holding our future. But we do know from the history it's not. Because the capitalist system not just ruining the ecological balance of the nature, but also they are ruining the whole, every single humanity feature on the earth. We need to take action all over the world so we can leave a better future to the humanity for the next generation. And this is gonna be the socialist ideology in my belief. Some people might say the socialism is not going to be a solution anymore, but the capitalism itself in the most capitalized countries going to cause the biggest problem in the future. It could be 40, it could be 50, it could be 100 years later. But the Mother Nature gonna take the revenge, and the human being gonna ask the capitalist modernity for what they went through so far. Kurdistan is a very rich country, in fact, with its underground resources holding nearly approximately 16% of the resources in all over the world, compared to all over the world. Such a rich geography, such a rich geostrategic area is interested in by any other nations, governments, countries. But the ISIS didn't appear just in one day and came to our life. We do know the capitalist modernity with its own chaos strategy, building up evils and then make us fighting against it. There are 64 countries, coalition, fighting against the ISIS. Airspace attacks. But ISIS expanding, more getting more powerful and causing more trouble. Who are fighting to the Islamic State in the Middle East? In fact, under really poor condition, when the ISIS attacked to the Mosul, Iraqi government with 1 million soldiers, with its oil resources, with its governmental history, with its population, could not fight to the Islamic State even 1 week. We have been fighting to the Islamic State since 2012 as an isolated nation. The world is blind to us. We do fight under really unbelievable poor conditions. We do lose our heroes just because they spent their last bullet because they are not armed. We got a people on front line, 80 years old, mothers, grandmothers, granddads, and fathers. We got a 14 years old, 12 years old children who are defending their own homes, village, and towns. And we do call the international community every single time we got a chance. This is not just a big issue for the Kurds. We did tell the international community that ISIS is gonna expanding all over the world. We did have a meeting with the international channels. I did speak on many international channels, many, many times. And we did strongly emphasize we need to unite together to fight against the Islamic State. I did call the international communities, please put the pressures on the governments. So we can push these evils back to the hell. And every single time, I got to say we are disappointed. We don't get enough support at all. European Union, NATO, UN. We are a non-state nation, and we are not invited to any meetings so we can put forward our knowledge and ideas to fight back to the Islamic State. EU just helped Turkey 3 billion euros last week to blockade the refugees not come into the Europe. Well, if you are on fire, you got to run away. But who are the ones put the fire on in the first place? Just last week, I was talking on RT International, and the Prime Minister of Turkey just said, if you prove we got a relationship with the terrorist organizations, I am going to resign. Yes, I got a proof. It's on my Facebook. It's the original paper which is being signed by the Turkish Home Office, sent to the local governments to support the Islamic State. So it is obligated to open the account to the international community who are behind the Islamic State and who are enemy to the humanity. We do say the politics is dirty business. Yes, it is dirty business. But if we don't fight back, we're never going to know the truth. So two issues right now in the Middle East destroying the humanity: the Islamic State and the relationship with the Islamic State governments. Dividing people into the religions. You are Christian, you are Muslim. Dividing people into the nationality. You are English, you are Kurdish. You are Turkish, you are Arabic. Dividing people into the sexuality. You are man, you are woman. Dividing people into the identity. Oh, you are cropped. I am so good. These are making our life and our future worse than ever. We got to think universal. We got to unite together. And we got to have enough courage to fight the devils. And if we put the pressures on governments all over the world, yes, we can manage. We did prove on our own for years and years to stop the Islamic State in the Middle East. Before the air strikes start, the war start in 2012. I do not say air strikes mean nothing, but look at the world and look at the politicians all over the world and look at their solutions. The Kurds even not part of their political solutions. The question is, the fact that Kurds has been fighting against the evils, Islamic States, and push them back to the ground, the most successful militants on the ground has been fighting for years and years, and they are not part of political solution. Why is that? Because Kurds do not believe the capitalist modernity. We do not fight over the petrol and oil and all that crap things. I do apologize for my bad language. We won't fight for that. Some people might be surprised. We can live with very limited resources since ever we have been. We're not greedy. We do fight for our honor and for the future of humanity. When the Yazidis in Shangal being attacked by the Islamic State, the Kurdistan regional government allies with the Turkish state, very good relationship with the NATO, UN. Well, everyone was expecting the UN and NATO gonna get into the Middle East and clean the whole dirt which is coming from the devils. Kick them out. It didn't happen. The Kurdistan regional government asked Turkey if they could get a military support. No. Saudi Arabia, no. Iraqi government, well, we are already in trouble. We're fighting back. The people who has been fighting in Rojava, the moment you have already watched on the video, the boys and the girls, the students, the Kurdistan Workers' Party, the People Protection Unit, they did went over the Shangal and fight against the Islamic State. Thousands and thousands of people moved onto the mountains. No food, no water, in the middle of summer, 40 degrees hot. So many kids lost their life. The woman who has been captured by the ISIS and who are managed to escape from the ISIS, who are managed to escape from the ISIS were on the mountains with the Kurdistan Workers' Party and People Protection Unit. The ISIS got the most powerful guns. The black market in the Middle East, over 1 million per week. And it is being proved monthly income from oil, a relationship between Turkey and Islamic State is over 10 million. So, Turkey is member of NATO and member of UN, and 64 countries already come together as a coalition. They're gonna run the airstrikes and gonna finish the ISIS. Well done. It won't happen. Right, we need to take a break. I just got a message from my friend in writing on the paper. I again, thanks every one of you come to listen to me, make your time for tonight this event, and we're gonna carry on the next session. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Bella.
You're welcome.
So, I'm just going to pass you to Giulio now, who's going to talk a bit about his work with Rojava Resiste, which is an Italian solidarity organisation.
Yeah, I've been in North Kurdistan in October with this group from made by activists from Milan and around Milan in Italy, that is called Rojava Resiste, and that had the aim or the aims to bring our practical solidarity to this experiment in Turkey and in Rojava, and to bring back enough documentation and enough interview to have a different account of what's happening, what was happening, and what's happening there. And our group worked on, let's say, two different levels. And one was made by a small group of artists that was with us, and I tried to create some common projects with other artists, local artists, and you can see in the picture some of the drawings of this Italian writer that has made these comics with the words, this like his style, and he has done this piece in Diyarbakir, in that is one of the biggest cities in the south of Turkey, with a local artist from there. But the problem has been that while we were there, in the city has been a curfew, has been imposed, and so it was impossible to finish the work together. But when we came back, luckily, we received a message. We kept keeping contact from, and the piece was finished in autonomy by the local artists there. And we've been involved with many different cultural groups that are working on the cultural resistance in Turkey to stop from the total assimilation or the total denial of the Kurdish culture. And that means that in the last 10 years there have been founded so many schools, Kurdish school, unofficial, because it's illegal to teach and to talk Kurdish. There have been founded academies that are cultural high school for music and theater and cinemas, and cultural center that are community centers where young people can learn even music, the language, the Kurdish language. And the other part of our travel was to try to find out what was happening in these autonomous municipalities that have declared the self-government since last August. But it's difficult to talk about these experiments without talking about the violence and the attacks from the Turkish state. That after the elections in June have increased to a level of violence that was very different from before. In June, the election bring a hang parliament. No party could create a government. And the project of Erdogan, the president of the republic and the head of the AKP, the government party, was to start a constitutional reform to have a more authoritarian and presidential government in Turkey. And in that election, the HDP, that is the pro-Kurdish party, managed to get inside the parliament, and it was the first time for a pro-Kurdish or Kurdish party to be able to get in the parliament. And so this project had been stopped at the time. And that was the time when the government decided to start to violently repress every Kurdish group and every Kurdish municipality in the area. And since August, in the district of Şırnak, that is next to the border with Syria and Iraq, some municipalities have declared the autonomy. What does it mean? That it's different from town to town, because now there are probably 10, if not hundreds, of town or neighborhood that have declared the autonomy. And so it's very different from an area to the other. But that means that there are groups, often supported by the local municipalities that are from this pro-Kurdish party, that have just started to create permanent meetings, parallel assembly, rather than the official elected one, to start to talk and to solve the problem of the different communities. And there have been, as I said, group of citizens starting to build new schools, starting to create workers' cooperative in town or in the countryside. There have been created people's houses to host these meetings. And the answer of the Turkish state has been the systematic use of curfew in all the different towns and different villages. And curfew means a block of water and electricity, total, block of communication with a special attention to the social media. Means physical block of a city, over a part of a city, and means that people can't get out from their home for the time that the curfew is on. And now we want to show you a video made from an activist in Turin, that it's about the 10 days of curfew in Cizre, and what did man mean for that city to have this situation imposed for such a long time.
Thank you. distretto di Şırnak, estremo sud-est della Turchia. 130.000 abitanti, la maggior parte dei quali curdi, ma anche assiri e armeni. Botan, come la chiamano i curdi, si trova a pochi chilometri dal confine siriano e iracheno. Fa parte di quello che viene definito Kurdistan Bakur, ovvero il Kurdistan del nord, che si trova totalmente in territorio turco. Qui nel 1992, durante le celebrazioni per il Neighbourhoods, il capodanno curdo, la città fu assediata dall'esercito turco per 12 giorni. 33 persone vennero uccise brutalmente. Nella storia di Cistra, resistenza e dolore si intrecciano da decenni. Nell'ottobre 2014 la città insorse per chiedere l'apertura del confine durante l'assedio di Kobane e 17 cittadini di Cisre persero la vita proprio combattendo contro le milizie dell'ISIS. Il 4 settembre 2015 un provvedimento del governatore di Şırnak dichiara lo stato di emergenza a Cisre. Un coprifuoco di 24 ore su 24 viene imposto alla popolazione. Nessuno può uscire di casa, l'ospedale viene chiuso, così come tutte le attività commerciali. Non c'è acqua né corrente elettrica, i cellulari non funzionano, Cisre è isolata dal mondo. Comincia l'assedio. È la mattina del 16 settembre quando entriamo in città. Il coprifuoco è terminato da nemmeno 48 ore. Le strade portano ancora i segni della battaglia, massi, sacchi di sabbia, veli per impedire i cecchini di uccidere, barricate, saracinesche esplose e muri distrutti.
Oh. Polisi ve askerleri gene önümüze barikatlar kurdu. Biz caddeden saparak farklı yollardan Cizre'ye girmeye çalıştık. Yaklaşık olarak 10 saat bir yürüyüşümüz oldu. Ve Cizre'ye girdiğimiz zaman hakikaten bir katliam vardı burada. Ve uluslararası kuruluşları da bu konuda duyarlılığa çağırıyoruz. Bu bugünkü mücadelemize devam edecektir.
يعني تو حياته ما بديني من الضربة تانقوي فا أتفهم كان هاي يعني تو حياته أنا إيش كده لا ده لا بيجي رجع بس لا ده بشيء شيء كشفت شيء كبير لا ده أنا شيء هوا شيء كده ما تبص على غد شيء هذا غد على ما في شيء كده جامع هذا جامع هذا يعني لا هلا بقى دقيق تو حياته ما لينا باي يعني الدنيا حمين برا به
Zaten Almanca erişi düzgün bize bir kaybetici kosaya demokratik elin genavi. Almanca bu projede. Ve Almanca bu kubid meclisi de hibiratına hatta haziran edi. Ve beheşti milletvekili kurduma derekhesi. Meçane sayya kurduma kost emri riya siyaseti. Emkho riya meclisi se temeli ana sahip çerçeveli emha bugün. Ve hanedan ber bir rad kredi. Biz buna ve gelin efendim ki riyal demokrasiye ne gelin kurd, gelin kurd düşü. Halk gördüm, biz ben ve erkek gelin kurd, peşen gel gelin kurd, gelin düşü her yeri zamanı var, parasını var, hasarıya var ilan gelin. Ve gelin kurd, tayyibatıcı gelin çizilir, ben bu hasarıya var demokratik ilan gelin. Sonra gelip ilan kredi muhabbetin gerekti. Muhabbetin destanı sahibinin zindana gelip mekhat haras bu emredi sistem ve pergaya kabul lakin ama kabul hali. Bu gördüm yani derinha heşbine ha. Bala Leyla İmber Sarıka Şahada ya bir derin bu. Eğer ona ki zulmü kurda bakın, bir savaş çeyreği. Sonra bir ahaltın abi, görev heldan, ertayzati görev heldan ya devleti sistemi bu diye böyle gelip bu en bu peygir ava, görev bu ava kutuyen şu görev heldan en kabul nakil naha dinlezme gelip kurdu. Bazı bir yuva tayyibatıcı suikastçı yuva seyavadan. Et hazır bir şey diyeceğim, gelinme ye çizildi, tefai sefil bu. Dugutun hemen pekekeli bu. Ev, vaki verdiği buna da çatamaniye, evi hani ne pekekeli bu. Ne heze iş olaj, gel yeşler ver bu. Hemuji gelinme ye sefil bu, sana devleti rahatan kadık kırın. Pensali gelin kurdu berkadıdı. Zulü peyve en yedi irada gelin kurdu en hevya sistemi pelgala devlete Türk en nahilin en fay her dışı fay avalkın.
سیامن دلداری ترسو خوفان چکن چکه بخورتی
Il coprifuoco è finito, la gente si riprende le strade, donne, uomini, bambini e anziani scendono in corteo per le vie dei quartieri, i bossoli dei proiettili, i buchi nei muri, lì dove c'era sangue, la morte e l'orrore, ora ritorna la vita. C'è il suono dei tamburi, le foto di chi non c'è più, le urla di battaglia delle donne e le dita che fanno il segno della vittoria. Basta guardare la gente di Cisre, basta guardare dritto negli occhi per capire. Qui nessuno si arrenderà. Cisre come Kobane, stesse scritte sui muri, stesse macerie per le strade, stessa determinazione a resistere. Qui Erdogan ha già perso.
Is the resistance to that curfew and to all the other curfews that have been imposed since then almost every day in one of the villages or cities in South Turkey. We've been in the same city in Cizre 1 month after the end of the curfew, and still, four of the neighborhood were completely close to the Turkish army or police. What does it mean? That since the 4th of September, since the declaration of self-government, four neighborhoods have just started to build barricades and to organize all the community life for the self-defense of the of those neighborhoods. And in that curfew, all the four neighborhoods had remained inaccessible to the tanks and to the vehicles of the police. And that's why what you've seen, the police, what the Turkish police is doing is a nasty attacks using snipers to kill everyone, every civilian who is going out of their home. And the concept of self-defense is go beyond just the armed struggle. There are armed groups loosely affiliated with the PKK, and in Cizre and in other town, they are called Yedege Ash and Yedege K Ash, that are the Yauth movement. And they fight only in the communities where they belong, and not in other places, every town, every village is their own. And they try, we have talked to a few of them in different places, and they have this policy trying to avoid to give weapons to two young people. But as we have seen, there were so many kids and guys from 14, 15 on that were helping, just like riding their bikes around the neighbors to check if the police was coming, or to stay on the roof to look at what the police was doing. And all the community life is organized in a communal way. So in those neighborhoods, in those situations, meals are together, decisions are taken always together, how to resist, when, how far. And we've been there, and we've been in another place that has been a very strong experience, that has been in Suruç, where in July, one ISIS attack has been done against this meeting of young socialists and anarchists that were there to bring their solidarity to Kobani, that is very close to Suruç, but on the other side of the Syrian border. And we've been there on the same day of the bombing in Ankara. And so we were there with the activists of this cultural center, where we were trying to find out if the people they know in Ankara were safe. And at the same time, they were obliged to remember what had happened in that place just a few months earlier. And what had happened was that after the attack and this suicidal attacker that blew himself, killing these 34 people, the police has blocked the area and has started to throw tear gas on the victims, and has blocked every possible way, every road to reach the hospitals. And these, as I have said earlier, it's difficult to talk of this strong experiment without talking about the resistance and the attacks of the police. But in all the different towns and villages where we've been, we've found a very different situation. We've seen in Cizre the proclamation of self-government has been made by the co-mayor, that in all the Turkish municipalities there are two mayors, one man and one woman. And this self-government proclamation has been made by the mayor, that then one of the two mayors that then has been removed by her duties. But in other places, instead, this happened just outside any official way of representation, just by communities that just decided, okay, now we are stopping with this and we are trying to build our society. And we've talked to a few of the people of these different places about their points of gender equality and of an ecological society. And this has been very interesting because it showed the dynamicity, how dynamic is the situation and how different from a place to another, where we've been told in Urfa, in one city, that we've been, that every group who come in Kurdistan from Italy, but from Europe always ask about women's rights, about abortion, about divorce, but this group are mostly made by men. And at the same time, they have just like showed us how women's rights are part of the program and of the movement, of the program of the movement. In another place, asking to the political representative of the HDP in Suruç, the situation was very different, because if in Urfa abortion, the right to abortion, the right of self-determination of the women over their body was assured, in Suruç the answers were quite different. So the role of the party was to try to make to solve the problem in the couple, so to try to find an accord, a solution between the couple. And when we have asked about the right to abortion, the answer has been, wait, no, life is sacred, we can't guarantee such a thing. And so the interesting thing is just that it's not that everywhere is, I don't know, this advanced libertarian experiment has managed to go through, but it's something undergoing, ongoing in every level of the societies. And as well, we've been in a couple of refugee camps from people from Iraq. One was all from Yazidi people, from Shangal, and another one from people from Kobani. And the interesting thing is that all these, the activities in the refugee camp are completely self-managed by the people who are living there. So there are schools, there are houses for women, there are organizations for education or for kids just playing around. And the important thing it was that Turkey wasn't assuring anything to those camps, but all the activities were made by the people living there, trying to reach NGOs, association, able to help. But I hope I gave you a very quick idea of what I've seen, at least can see what is happening, but what we have been able to see with our own eyes. And then, if we want to keep going.
Cool, thanks, Julian. So now, Binan's going to talk a little bit more about the massacres in East Turkey, following on from the film, and then maybe a bit about the Şilan case, the case of the young British Kurdish woman who's recently been imprisoned for attempting to travel and fight with Kurdish resistance.
Right, I hope you haven't been bored. We're supposed to be taking a break for a while, but it didn't work, so we got to go on. The Turkish state has been attacking to the Kurds, not only in the Rojava, in the southeast Turkey, Kurdish regional area as well. I would focus on two factors, dynamics, why they are attacking both in Rojava and in southeast Turkey. The Kurds has been fighting very successfully in Rojava against the Islamic State and pushed back Islamic States. So their territorial integrity or political sovereignty getting narrow. Turkey trying to fight back to the Kurds in Turkey, in Kurdistan region, to make sure the powers who are fighting against the Islamic State
they would fight to the Turkish army at the same time. Powerless Kurds could be beaten easier. That's part of the strategy, the military strategy right now working in Kurdistan. They do destroy the towns. They do destroy the villages. They kill the babies. 35 days baby being held in the frozen fridge for nearly 8 days because the family couldn't get out the baby to bury the ground. No morals, no values, no respect to the international law by the Turkish state. So the Turkish state getting worse than even the Islamic state. Whatever the Islamic state used as a method in Rojava against the Kurds, it has been used by the Turkish state exactly the same in south of Kurdistan, south of Turkey, which is we call Kurdistan area. Yeah, the Kurds in the area protecting their own homes and lands for their own freedom and for the honor of humanity. They are under the attacks and they got a right to defend themselves. The fighters, young teenagers, elders, parents, consist of civilian people. They do fight back to the professional, specialist Turkish army. And they do fight pretty well, to be honest. Because the Turkish army still in a dream of Ottoman Empire. They do believe they can rebuild the Ottoman Empire in the Middle East. They do see the first or the most important factors, dynamics, who are fighting back to the Turkish dreams are Kurds. That's why the Turkish imperialism and the racism focusing on Kurds. Well, if you remember, at the time of the World War I, the most important two towns, Mosul and Kirkuk, that's the strategic place of oil. Turkey sent the troops over there, which is in the Kurdistan regional area. And the PKK who fighting against the Turkish in the southeast Turkey strongly emphasized, we're gonna stand up against the Turkish imperialism and fight back. We do fight under the law of to protect ourselves, and we do respect to the international law. We do not fight against the civilians. We do not bomb the Turkish villages. We do not make a discrimination on the streets, on the shoppings, in any way, in the social lives between the Turks and Kurds or any other cultures or nationalities. Because we do know they are just civilians, same as us. But the Turkish government, member of NATO and UN, got no moral, got no values, no respect to the international law. Airstrikes right over the top of the towns and villages and bombing the kids and women, civilians. And for what reason the world is blind and deaf to all these things, just rather than the international community, respectful people like you right now listening to us. That's the main case. We need to put the pressure on the governments to make sure they take the right political decisions, which is gonna bring the morals, values, and democratic features to our lives, rather than destroying. UK, one of the strongest governments running the strategical, economical, and political policy all over the world.
And I do request every one of you here, to your ability, if you got any chance, please do write to the politicians, put the pressure, demonstrations, anything you can organize in Bristol to make sure we can bring the Kurdish questions into the attention. I do thanks to every one of you listening to me regarding these questions. I would like to point out some few words regarding the Shilan Özçelik. She was born in UK, teenager. Regarding the Islamic State attacks, she did get really emotional. She tried to do something, same as any of us. She went to Europe and joined some political activities. And the UK declared Shilan as a terrorist member of the PKK. Because the PKK is defined as a terrorist organization by the EU, NATO, America, England, Western global powers. Even though they got a relationship with the PKK, which is, we know, proved. Even though they talk positively regarding the PKK in front of our eyes. Even though the fact that PKK has been fighting against the Islamic State as a most powerful dynamic in the Middle East, defined as a terrorist organization. We do call international powers delist PKK as a terrorist organization. Because the PKK and the other Kurdish units, they do represent the democratic future in the Middle East. The only secular movement. Who are you gonna establish a new Middle East with? With what mentality? The ISIS mentality? Or the Ottoman Empire mentality? Or just a woman led to have representation to vote in the Saudi Arabistan last week? With the Arab, Saudi Arabia? With the Middle Age mentality based on the religions and discriminating people, making people fight to each other? With these people? No way. There is one option, which is, we know it is right. Secular, democratic, acceptable, and at the same time, non-state nation, but the most dynamic, strong, and political movement, Kurdish movements. So I do call to the governments, I do call to the international community, please make sure we bring these issues to the attention of the communities, people, and we're going to have a better future. The global world needs a global economy and global policy. So, none of the country, none of the government could say, well, that's not my issue. Of course, it's your issue. The companies for the oils in the Middle East, the companies in UK, most of them abroad. Yes, we got to know how to live together, and we got to know how to come to a peaceful political solutions. And Kurds with 40 million in the Middle East been divided by the imperialists now, asking to the international powers, they got a right to live same as any other one, free. And we do know we're gonna live with every single one of you who are peaceful and who are secular. We are not gonna live with the ISIS mentality. Chilanos Çelik, as I said, in Holloway prison right now, being sentenced to 21 months. You know why? Involved in activities against the ISIS. I tell you what, in Bristol there are so many people went to the ISIS and came back. And they're on the streets right now. And as a researcher, I know their profiles. Why won't you arrest them? Because you got a relationship with the Turkish government, and the Turkey is member of NATO. Your political and economical interests requires to criminalize and terrorize Kurds. We need a left wing, we need a socialist, we need a radical democracy in this country to make sure we're gonna get better future altogether. We need a proper labor. We need a proper socialist. We need a proper green parties so we can have a better future together. We can make world better, any of us. Once we start somewhere, we're gonna see there are abilities to make it better. Şilanos Çelik was one of the one who are in the same belief with me. And she's in prison right now for the 21 months. That's the case which is an example. One of the government organization tomorrow could turn up and say, Mr. Tansel, we do clarify and classify you as a member of terrorist organization. Why is that? We are the ones against the violence. We are the productive one. We are the one active fighting for the human being. So compared to the ISIS, what would you think? The people who are joining the Islamic State are on the street in Bristol, and the people who are against the Islamic State in the prison. I leave it to you. Would you accept that? It could be one of you tomorrow. So we got to bring to the attention government, attention to the government, and make sure they're gonna run the right policy about the issues. The time is running out. It was really nice to meet every one of you. I think we're gonna have some questions from you after this. I pass to my friend, so if the question time, yeah? Okay, I'm just a bit confused, sorry.
Yeah, I don't have it with me, but we'll make sure we put the Şilan Ercelek prison address up on the Facebook afterwards, for those of you who've been following the event there. So, yeah, we've got time for some questions then. And if people want to bail sometime during this, please remember to chuck us some quids on the way out. It would really be helpful. But has anyone thought of any question? Does anyone have anything to pay?
We're waiting for our Kurdish brother. I'm just wondering what your opinion would be on this. Would you say that the reason why Western powers have failed to act and put feet on the ground, support the Kurdish armies, is exclusively on level with the relationship between the British and Western governments and Turkey? Or would you say potentially it's part of a bigger, potentially colonialist, potentially capitalist agenda?
Thank you for your question. Well, if we look at the bigger picture, it is regarding the capitalist modernity. So, some regimes in the Middle East are really in good relationship with the Western powers, politically and economically, because they got a relationship for a long time. It's historical. The strategy doesn't turn up in a small time of small period of the time. So it needed really big developments in the region so they can change it. On the other hand, because these relationships between the capitalist modernity in the Middle East and in the Western countries, they do need each other. In any way, they do need each other. But the main question here is, do we got a better option or no? Yes, we got a better option. The better option is, we are believing in labor power. We are socialists. It doesn't matter how good relationship Turkey and UK going through, but we do know it's not going to be for our benefit. It's not going to be for your benefit or my benefit, but it is going to be for the benefit of capitalized classes. So that's the answer. Thank you.
I know that there's been somebody who's gone off to join ISIS from Bristol, the one person that was in the mainstream media, but what evidence do you have to suggest that other people have gone off to join and then come back as well on top of that?
Well, we do know on the media there are some people with their profile being published went to the ISIS. And we do know, as a community, there are some people getting organized in Bristol, and they got a pretty good relationship in direct way to the ISIS. We do know they gather the money, put together and send over. We do know having the meetings, and we do know they use the religion as a material to brainwash the people. So if you're gonna fight against the Islamic State, you're not gonna wait until the people come to the point to join the Islamic State. If you're gonna fight the Islamic State, you got to make sure they're not gonna get organized first. It could be here, there, or somewhere else. So, I am not intelligence service to make sure I can prove every single thing. But I am a researcher. So, if there are some people joined to the ISIS in Bristol, and if they are still getting organized, that means there would be other people to join the ISIS. Thank you very much.
Cool. Anyone else? Oh yeah, right over there.
What can people here do to support the Kurdish resistance in Syria and also in Kurdistan?
Well, without getting organized, every single help and support is gonna be just relying on yourself. But we do know there are so many civil organizations in Bristol. And we do know there are international revolutionaries. We do know there are some charities. We need to come together and to make sure we can have a professional help in any way. It's not just economically. It could be economical side because the area under the attack and fighting under the really poor conditions, it's the most urgent case right now. But even if, as I said today, if you bring all what I have been saying so far to the attention of the community and attention of the government, if you put the pressure on the government, yeah, we can raise up our voice. We can help one to another by getting organized. It is pretty well organized today, thanks to the organizers. So we had a chance to talk about it. We can have a different sort of activities. We can have a meeting in the Bristol. Why not? We can have a meeting in the Bristol after Christmas. It could work. I did organize a meeting years ago when the Turkey attacked the Kurdistan regional area with nearly 300 people by the Green Party, held a meeting, and it was a good meeting, good demonstration. That sort of things could be happen. Thank you very much.
In your opinion, why does the Turkish state support IS? What's their motivation?
Well, the first of all, I believe it is common interest in the Middle East, because Turkey is one of the countries who are dealing with the black market, oil market, with the ISIS, and it has been proved. So if I say I would have a relationship with you, 10 million per week over the oil, and if you buy the oil for £10 from somewhere else, and if I sell to you for £2, why would you give up the relationship? You won't, as long as you are having good relationship and it is not being proved by the international world. That's why I say we have to put the pressure on the governments who got the links with the ISIS. The militants, members of ISIS who are fighting to the Kurds, we do get so many evidences on them. Turkish flag as a tattoo on their body. They got a fake identities from the official Turkish government organizations. Financial, military aids going from Turkey and Saudi Arabia. that's not secret anymore. It's so open and it is so well known. Thank you very much.
I was just wondering what you thought the relationship that's been come to light recently of the between the KRG and the Turkish government, military aid and stuff like that. What's going on there?
As you know, after the Saddam, the KRG came to the power, like it is free part of Kurdistan. It's not exactly, it's federation. When I look at the big picture, I see the Western governments got a pretty well relationship with the Turkey. And the KRG, under the protection of the Western government, because it's pretty well producing oil. That part of Kurdistan is well known for its oil. So many companies in Kurdistan regional area, from England, UK, from America, from Western countries, they do really good profit on oils. And the relation, because Turkey, member of NATO, and UN, and got a good relationship with the Western powers. This is like a block of global powers, alliance-ness. So KRG taking place on that side. They do see their own interest to be with the Turkey rather than being with a socialist groups like YPG or PKK. That's the main issue. But if we say there is not common interest, of course there is a common interest. Recently, in all over the part of Kurdistan, they got a good relationship. But Middle East is somewhere like very highly complicated area. It's not like any other part of the world. As long as in the Middle East there is no justice between the cultures, nations, religions, never problem gonna be end up. After the Lausanne Treaty came into the force, Kurdistan being divided into the four under the occupation of different countries. The signatory countries who are on the powers are well known. So, if you do not bring a peaceful solution, injustice in the first place, would you think, did you end up that problem? No. It would come up 10 years, 20 years, 50 years later. In the Europe, after the Second World War, when all the treaty came into the force, some governments in the Europe come up with the arguments, it is not on our interest, territorial dignity or integrity or political sovereignty. Then, after the First World War, Second War come up, the Germany said, oh, I don't recognize the Versailles Treaty. It's not on my own interest. But it's same things all over the world. If we're gonna sort out the problems in the Middle East, we got to make sure every nation, every culture, every religion, whoever live in the area, they can have their own freedom. Or we need a solution in a confederalism way so they can live together. We can't just on the side who got the power and make sure we got our own interest, common interest with them, and then ignore the others. Thank you very much.
Sorry, I do apologize.
Cool. Are there any other questions? Okay, one here.
So, is your understanding that there would be, if there was a resolution to the problem in Syria, you're saying the Kurdish people would have no interest in a state within that or any other area? You'd just like to dissolve borders and stay autonomous?
Well, what I think, we do want a statue, is definitely, we need to be defined one way or another according to the international law. Statue could be different, it could be autonomous, it could be federation, it could be state, like independent state, but what I would say, the first preference is not state, because 19th century, let's go through the 19th century, the national states. We don't believe the nationalism, national states bring out the peaceful solution into our life. In Europe, even in Europe, the most civilized and capitalized countries, the modern capitalism is not a solution. And the nationalism is not a solution as well.
It just gives you a voice to take.
So we need to find a solution where we can live together with different ethnicity, with different nationality, different cultures. But at the same time, everybody must have their own freedom rights. If the Kurds got the rights to have the federation, then that federation is going to be with the Assyrians, Armenians, Syrians, whoever live in the area. So, one ethnicity, one culture, one identity, not going to say, oh, this is my country. So, this is everybody's country. Whoever live there, it belongs to them. Thank you very much.
So it's very clear that the opposition to ISIS, from where you're from and from the Kurdish people, is very left-wing. Unfortunately, in this country, predominantly the opposition to ISIS comes from the right-wing. And that's a shortcoming of the left, I think, in this country. Do you have experience of like dealing with right-wing like fascist groups that are saying yes, we want to join your struggle against ISIS? How do you deal with that?
Well, I do believe in principles. Of principles. I got my own personality, and I do believe the Kurdish movement got his own personality as well. Well, I don't say we are very strict with everything, it's not going to work, but I would say we would prefer to stand up with the socialist, anti-fascist group rather than the right wings. It is clear the right wings are more sensible regarding the Islamic State than the left wing, but we got to question ourselves. We are the ones who are represent the democratic values. We are the ones who are believing equality. We are the one who has been fighting against the fascism all the history through today. So why right wing? Because the right wing, ideological, is some sort of enemy to the Islamic State. Somebody might believe in Christianity, he might just hate the Muslims. he might take that way. Somebody might believe in nationalism, might hate someone else. It works that way. It doesn't work properly the way we say it. So maybe I won't be able to enough to clarify your question because of my English. But as I said, we would rather stand with the anti-fascist groups, parties, organization than the right wings. If the right wings are more sensible than us, then we have to question ourselves. Thank you very much.
Obviously, recently we had the vote in Parliament about whether to carry out the airstrikes in Syria against ISIS. Obviously, we were already having airstrikes against them in Iraq. Do you feel that the airstrikes were the right option? If not, what would you refer to as that?
Well, when we make a decision, we got to have a knowledge of the area. So, if any of you remember 2003 or 2006, when the Western powers used to bomb the Iraq in Basra, or 2006 in Afghanistan, it didn't work itself, did it? Airstrike on its own doesn't work. But we do know in the Middle East when the ISIS, as a nightmare, came through the area, and when the Kurds fight on the ground, push them back. So the most successful military power on the ground are Kurds. Why not supporting Kurds to defeat the ISIS? Because the airstrike on its own not gonna work.
So what form of support would you use? Sort of, would that be troops on the ground, with no fly zone, or?
Well, we got the troops enough on the ground.
Yeah.
I don't think we need the troops. We need the heavy guns. We need the money. And we need the enough support. Then ISIS would be nothing. Because the ISIS build up itself on the terror, horror. Give the impression out, we are unbeatable. It's not true. We did fight under the really poor condition, and we pushed them back. We can do it again. All we need a international support. Thank you very much.
Great. Well, thank you very much for our speakers tonight.
Thank you.